Paraphrasing Martin Oderski, the creator of Scala, functional programming is, on its most fundamental level, simply programming with functions. A function is a piece of code that takes some data as arguments, performs some operations on it, and returns the result as another piece of data. Adding 2 and 2 is a function. Both numbers are arguments. The name of the function is add, if we want to use the standard notation, or the plus sign, if we want to use an operator. Both are equivalent. The result is 4. Of course, not only numbers can be data. Although, strictly speaking, yes, only numbers. We have booleans, false and true, but these are just zeros and ones. We have strings, which are sequences of characters, but these characters are really just numbers which are interpreted as letters of the alphabet when we display them to a human being. We have complex data structures, but they consist of simpler data structures which are eventually made of numbers. We have pointers or references, depending on the programming language. They are addresses of where we can find other data, but these addresses are also basically just numbers. In imperative programming, functions and data are separate concepts. Data is what a function works on. A function is what works on data. They belong to different worlds. In functional programming, functions are also data. Data which tells us what to do with other data. We can use a function as an argument for another function, so that higher order function will be able to use it at some point of its own operation. If you wonder how it can work in practice, I will give you just the first of many examples – collections. In programming, collections are everywhere. If there's only one piece of data, there's nothing to do with it. What would it be anyway? Your name? Your name is a sequence of characters. A location? A location makes sense only if there are other locations to compare it with. Aside from very trivial examples, no matter what your program does, at some level there is a collection of different elements that gives meaning to the program's functionality. And when you have a collection of elements, you can perform operations on them. Operations mean functions. For example, you can have a bag, a collection of cats, and you want to have a bag of black cats only. So you use the filter method of the collection. The filter method takes the collection as its first argument, a subject, so to say, called this, or self, and as its second argument, a function which for every cat will return true or false. The result of the filter method is a new collection with only those cats in it which pass the test. In our case, those which are black. In imperative programming, to do that, we would use a loop. We would create a new, mutable, empty collection at first, and then run a for loop for all cats in the original collection, and if they are black, we would put them in the new collection. Two problems here. First, the mutable bag of black cats will stay mutable even after the loop finishes, which makes the code vulnerable to someone adding more cats, maybe even not black ones, later. Second, we have to write our own loop functionality, even if it's the same functionality we were writing again and again for years since our first programming course. It's boring, it takes time, and because of the routine, it's even possible that we will write it wrong and try to access an overflowing cat and get a cat out of range exception. Functional programming lets us separate the code that takes care of iterating over the collection and that which actually cares about what this collection consists of and what to do with it. The first part doesn't care if it's a bag of cats or dogs, or maybe something completely different, as long as it is a collection of elements which can be filtered. This way, we can put the implementation of the filter method in the connections library and never think of it again. Similarly, we have other methods like map, flat map, for each, fold, and traverse. I don't think I need to discuss them here in detail, but I'd like to point out that each of them encapsulates a way of operating on elements in a collection that does not need to know what elements it operates on. all that's left to do for us is to give those methods more specific functions as arguments, so they will know what to do. That means less code for us to write, and thus fewer opportunities to make errors, and more time to argue on Twitter. A function is a piece of code that takes arguments and produces a result. When we talk about total and partial functions, it means that we are interested in the type of the argument and whether we can produce a result from it.
Or we can say that we are interested in the function's domain and the codomain. So let's say we have a function mul, which performs the multiplication. It takes two integers, x and y, and produces a third integer, the result of multiplying x and y. Our multiplication function is total. You can provide any two integers to it and you will obtain a result of the declared type, int, as well. But how about division? Let's say we have another function, div, which looks like this. For a lot of values of x and y, the div function gives a proper result of the type int, but you already see where we are going. If x can't be divided by y without a remainder, in Scala the remainder will be ignored and we will get only the integer part. For example, div 5 and 2 is equal to 2. It's surely not an ideal solution. More importantly, for y equal to 0, another weird thing happens. We get an arithmetic exception. It means that a division of a pair of integers which produces an integer is a partial function. It does not work for all pairs of integers. Again, from a more mathematical point of view, we can say that such a function is a mapping from one set of elements to another. The set of arguments, in our case, are all tuples or pairs of integers. The set of results are all integers, not pairs, just integers. The function tries to map each tuple from the set of arguments to one of integers in the set of results. The multiplication function is able to do it, but the division function fails for some tuples. The division function is partial. It doesn't mean that partial functions are never useful. Sometimes we can use to our advantage the fact that they work only on a subset of possible input. One such popular case in Scala is the collect method in collections, also called filter map in some other languages like Rust. It's a shorthand for a common case where we first filter the original collection and then map the obtained subset to get a smaller collection of something else. Instead of having to first filter the whole collection and then map over the subset, we can use collect and provide it with a partial function which will work only for a subset of elements and it will map them. Collect will ignore all elements which the partial function doesn't work for. There are two ways to turn a partial function into a total one. One is to simply broaden the domain and or the codomain.
In our case, to change the result type from int to double and make a small change in the implementation so that we will convert x and y to double before we use it. The type double represents rational numbers, not only integers but also fractions, but only down to a certain number of zeros after the dot. And on top of that, we have two constants, infinity and minus infinity, and one magic not a number. If y is equal to 0 and x is larger than 0, we will get infinity as the result. Similarly, if x is smaller than 0, we will get minus infinity. And if x is equal to 0, we will get not a number. That virtually solves all our problems, but it also forces us to deal with a result type that is more flexible than that what we might have wanted. Well, what if we actually wanted to use the div function only for integers, which can be divided without a remainder, and any other outcome should be treated as an error? That's how the other, better way works. It turns a partial function into a total one using types to better describe what the function can accept as arguments and what it returns. We will discuss that in one of the next videos. Here the only thing that is important right now is that it gives us better control. A correctly defined type is a piece of information that can help us avoid many errors. We can use this information to narrow down our scope of thinking and focus on what's important to us, our happy path, and at the same time clearly outline corner cases and errors. We can also pass it to other developers as a form of minimalistic but always available and always up-to-date documentation. We say, this function here takes only arguments of such and such types, nothing else will be accepted, but also all arguments which conform to these rules are always valid. And it returns results exactly like that, nothing more. That's it for today. Thank you for watching. In the next video, we will talk about pattern matching, a feature which can let us write very powerful code if we defined our types well, and about smart constructors and field traits. As always, if you have any questions or want to contact me for another reason, you can just leave a comment below, or you can also find me on Twitter. See you next time.